So good morning, everybody. Let's start the second morning session, which is dedicated to boron. And we have two speakers, one coming from Catalonia here in Barcelona and the other from Japan. So the first speaker is Professor Clara Viñas. She came from the Institut de Ciencia de Materiales de Barcelona, the ICMAB of the CSIC, the Consejo Superior de Investigación Científica. Professor Viñas, from the biography that I got from the website of the conference, graduated in chemistry and then in pharmacy at the Universitat Autonoma of Barcelona for chemistry and the Universitat de Barcelona for pharmacy. Then we moved to the United States for a predoctoral student, came back to Barcelona, working first in the industry and then to a municipal laboratory of Sabadell, taking care of environmental control and food analysis, so on and so forth. Then she got the PhD degree in pharmacy, again at the University of Barcelona, and she moved to CSIC in 1991. When there, she became full professor in 2006, and she is currently at CSIC here in this prestigious institute in Barcelona. Research interests span different areas of boron chemistry, and carborains, metallic carborains, and the target is the applications of these compounds in medicinal chemistry. Today, Professor Viñas will talk about harmony between boron clusters and phosphorus moieties, enhances the properties of resulting nanomaterials. You know the time that you have allocated. Please stay in time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Peruzzini, for your kind introduction, and good morning. Let me start my presentation putting this question. Is there available any molecule purely of inorganic nature that allows functionalization similar to the organic compounds do? And the answer is yes. The clorocarborains. Clorocarborains are present in three different isomers, the ortho, meta, and para. Today, I will present results on the metacarborane. All the three isomers are thermodynamic and oxidative stables, but they produce a versatile reactivity. They are hydrophobic, and the space, the volume is similar to the one of benzene in rotation. But what it is important is that in the same space, the number of atoms is twice the one of the benzene. As I say, it's possible to do substitutions in both sides of the cluster, at the carbon or at the borons. The substitution at the carbon starts with a base attack, while the substitution at the boron is electrophilic substitution. In our laboratory, we have produced all this type of derivatives of the orthocarborane. We have done the monosubstitution at the carbon, this substitution with both homosubstitution, or hetero-disubstitution. And we also have produced mono, D, and tetrasubstitution at the boron vertexes. This is one way to represent this type of substituents. Yesterday, Dr. Kelemen presented one example of one of these derivatives by producing gold nanoparticles. And this evening, Professor Teixidó will present other two examples. But today, just how we design these molecules, we thought that we wanted to obtain molecules with high boron content to be applied in medicine for one technique that it is named boron neutron cation therapy. So we needed to have molecules with high boron contents. So this was an idea how the boy is moving the kite in the air. So we thought it was possible to prepare such a type of molecules with a vector just to go to the target place. So with this in mind, we have been synthesized several types of molecules. I have divided my lecture in two parts. The first one deals on merging neutral boron cluster and phosphorus through a bond between the cluster and the phosphorus atom. In the laboratory, we have prepared phosphinic and phosphonic acids of both isomers, the ortho and the meta. But today, I am going to present only some results on the meta phosphinic acid. This is the type of molecule we have designed, and our goal was the preparation of iron oxide nanoparticles covered or capped with this carboranyl phosphinate, with the aim to develop high boron content magnetic nanoparticles able to act as anti-cancer drug by dual therapy, by BNCT and thermotherapy. BNCT related with the shell of the nanoparticle, and thermotherapy because of the core of the nanoparticle. So, the first step was the preparation of the iron nanoparticles that was done by co-precipitation method. And after filtration by magnetization, we obtained the core of the nanoparticle. The next step was to add, next step was to add to a suspension of these magnetic nanoparticles an aqueous solution of the carboranyl phosphinate. And after sonication, purification and separation, the magnetic nanoparticles were obtained. This TEM image is a proof of how the nanoparticles are. And also, the distribution provides us information about the size of these nanoparticles, that it's about 7.5 nanometers. So once the nanoparticles were prepared, we go for the characterization, and the X-ray power diffraction clearly show us that the magnetic nanoparticles has the same contains the core of the magnetic nanoparticles. And also the measurements of magnetization provide us information that they are supermagnetic. And the SEM and EDX provide us information that we have iron, oxygen, and phosphorus. To be sure that our magnetic nanoparticles are capped with the carboranyl phosphinate, we run three different infrared spectra. At the top is the infrared spectra of the ligand, and at the bottom is the infrared spectra of the core of the nanoparticles, and in the middle it's the new nanoparticles capped with carboranyl phosphinate. So the presence of the band in the area 2,500 or 2,600 give us information of the presence of the ligand, because this is the frequency in where the boron hydrogen appear and no other bonds appear in this area. And if we look at the finger part of the spectra, this part provide information on the coordination of the phosphinate to the magnetic nanoparticle. And because of the bands that we observed, we were sure that phosphinate coordinates to the magnetic nanoparticles in a bidentate way. Next step, because we wanted to use these nanoparticles for medical purposes, the next step was to test about the stability of these new magnetic nanoparticles with the pH. And we take advantage of the dynamic light scattering, and we observe that when decreasing the pH, increases the size of the nanoparticles. And also, we wanted to know about the stability of the new nanoparticles with different media, in different temperatures, and different times. So we use, once again, the dynamic light scattering, and with three different culture media, one, two, and three. And we observe that these two media are the best because our nanoparticles are stable during 24 hours and also at the room temperature at 37 degrees, that which is the temperature where the cells are cultivated. So once we knew about the stability, we check about the in vitro studies of the new carboranyl phosphinate magnetic nanoparticles. Two types of cells were selected. This is a cancer one, and this is a health cells one. This was in collaboration with Anna Roussel in the Hospital Vallebron in Barcelona. And what we observe is that the time and the doses, the amount of iron into the cells is time and dosis dependent for both of the cell lines. And also what it was observed is that the one type of cells is more sensitive to our magnetic nanoparticles than the other one. Next, we wanted to know if our nanoparticles has been entered into the cell. And what we use is this test, the Prussian blue iron stain. And clearly, the blue color provides information that the iron is inside the cells. And this is a control. There is no blue color. There is no iron, obviously. So when we prove chemically that the iron it was inside the cells, what we did is to visualize by means of the TEM that the magnetic nanoparticles were inside the cells. And in both cases, the magnetic nanoparticles were found. So both techniques prove us that the core of the magnetic nanoparticles was inside the cells, but no one give us any information on the stability of the ligand, the shell of the nanoparticles. So what to do? And we take advantage of the XPS technique. At the right, there is the full spectra, and at the left, there is a magnification of the peaks that correspond to the boron and to the phosphorus. In black is the nanoparticles alone, and in red is the cells that have been in contact with magnetic nanoparticles were dry, and we ran the spectra, and both peaks clearly confirm that both the core and the core and the shell was inside the cells. So this is what we wanted, as I say, because of the to use these magnetic nanoparticles for a cancer therapy by using dual therapy, hyperthermia therapy, because of the core of nanoparticles, and boron neutron cation therapy because of the shell of the nanoparticle. And For this, it is important that the enough amount of boron 10 enter into the cell. So, first of all, let me expose what is boron neutron capture therapy. Boron neutron or BNCT, it's a bimodal therapy that it is based in the large surface area of the boron 10 to capture slow neutrons or thermal neutrons. The boron 10 dismute producing lithium alpha particles and photons. So if we have a cancer tissue that it is formed of cancer cells plus healthy cells, usually the cancer tissue is very well irrigated. So it means that more blood that other tissues arrive. So if the drug is in the blood, more B10 can be in the spar. So once we know that the boron is inside the cells, it's time to irradiate with thermal neutrons in order to produce the alpha particle that will kill the cells and probably the healthy cells will divide once again. But to apply BNCT, at least two other requirements. One of the requirements is that the amount of boron 11 was more or less about 20 micrograms per grams of tumor. This is one thing, and the second is to be sure that the boron compound is inside the cells. So we already know this, and we test the amount of boron in the cells was calculated, and the value is 26 micrograms per grams de cell. So it seems that both requirements are accomplished for our magnetic nanoparticles. So the next step was in collaboration with Universitat of Torino and Pavia, and they prepare four plates. In two of them, the cancer cell was in contact only with the media, and in two of the samples, in the media was added the magnetic nanoparticles. So, after 24 hours of incubation, two of these samples were irradiated, one from the control and the second one that has been in contact with the magnetic nanoparticles. And it was nice to observe that after the irradiation, in the day six, the growth of the cells that have been in contact with the boron sample and being irradiated for 15 minutes decreased 2.5. So this was a great results. So before to start in vivo studies, one test was done that is very simple. Doctora Anna Rossell in Vallebron took three different groups of mice. One group as a control. A second group, it was injected one amount of magnetic nanoparticles every day during 10 days, and the same by using not the magnetic nanoparticles but only the carboronyl phosphate, because we did not know if inside the body the shell will be removed and the toxicity becomes from the capping. But it was nice to observe and that the weight it was not increase or decrease respect the control group. So these are very good results for starting new for continuing with this research. And the second part of my talk is related with the metallocarburanes. It was in 2011 when in our group we observed that the protonate cosine in a very diluted solution in water produces monolayer vesicles with a radius more or less about 20 nanometers. If the concentration of the cosine increases, at that time the vesicles and spheric missiles coexist. And if we use diluted solution of the protonate cosine, but not in water solution, in saline solution, the monolayer vesicles are also formed, but in this case, the size of these vesicles enlarges in this range of radius between 80 and 890. It was the driving force that produces the vesicles or the dihydrogen interaction between the anionic clusters. It was in 2014 when we demonstrate that the anionic cosine crosses the artificial membrane as well as the cellular membrane, and it accumulates into the cells. And we prove by using Raman microscopy that the compound that it is inside the cells has a boron hydrogen bond, because once again the Raman in this part of the spectra in where no other frequencies appear. And later, 1 year later, what we study is about the toxicity of the cosine. And it was in collaboration with the University of Cardiff, and we test on mammalian cells that are healthy and cancer cells with amoeba and with bacteria. And what we observe is that the cosine is not toxic, it's only cytostatic. I mean, it stops the cellular division. And it's not toxic at all, because once we knew the efficient dosis 50, what we did is to add into the culture media 200 times more of this value, and the cells stop growing. And when removing, after several days, the cellular division starts once again. We also prove in vivo that this cosine can be biodistributed, and by doing this, what we prepare is the monoiodinated of the cosine. And in collaboration with one former student of our group that is working in Biomagune, Jordi Llop, he produces the isotopic. We send to him the iodo cosine, being the iodo in natural state. And what they do was to interchange iodine natural by iodine 124, and by using positron emission tomography, it was observed that the compound was concentrated in lung and liver. And also, it was confirmed by using the photon emission computerized tomography. In this case, by using iodine 125. And this shows how after 10 minutes, 30 minutes, and 2 hours, the concentration at the lung increases while in the blood decreases. So we knew that the cosine produces monolayer vesicles, what it means a high boron content. It's able to cross biological membrane. and apparently is not toxic for the cells. So we knew that our cosine was inside the cells, but we did not know in what part of the cell. So in collaboration with Doctora Fernanda Márquez in Portugal, he made the biological studies two types of cancer cells were chosen, and after the uptake studies, the cells were destroyed and the different parts of the cell isolated. And it was using this type of technique, it was possible to know about the intracellular cosine distribution. And it can be seen, most of the cosine is in the membranes, but also in the nucleus. So when we observe this, we say in the nucleus, mainly there are genetic material, I mean DNA. So does the cosine interact with DNA? Just to answer this question, what we did was to prepare a nanohybrid that it was formed by the cosine and the calf thymus double strand DNA. So this is the optical microscopy image at the beginning, and this is the optical microscopy image of the nanohybrid. So it's clear that DNA has different behavior. So in order to know more about the interaction, what we did was first to run the infrared spectra and the Raman spectra, and to look at the area in where the boron hydrogen appear. We ran the spectra of the cosine alone, the spectra of DNA, and the spectra of the nanohybrid. And it's really clear that the spectra of the nanohybrid presents the band in this area, what it confirms that the nanohybrid has cosine in the formation. So, just to be completely sure of this, we use other techniques, melting temperature that increases, clear evidence that there is interaction. We observe by UV also the interaction, by circular dichroism, and by cyclic volt amperometry. So all the techniques provide information that there is an interaction between the cosine and the double-strand DNA. But the interaction depends, is not always the same. It can be intercalative or electrostatic, depending on the ionic strength of the solution. Also, we study biodynamic light scattering in water and in a phosphate buffer solution, what happened with the vesicles of the cosine when we were adding to the solution increasing concentration of DNA. And what we observe, this is the size of the vesicle, that adding DNA, the size increases in both cases, in water and in the phosphate buffer solution. And here we have some image, TEM image of how these vesicles look. And to finish, what we did is in collaboration with Professor Nakamura to study because we wanted to know about how in vivo this the interaction of the cosine. And what we study first is the interaction in whole blood. And what we observe is that the interaction with the plasma takes place very, very fast. After 10 minutes, there is a lot of cosine in the plasm. And more or less is the same quantity after 60 minutes. And the quantity of the cosine into the erythrocytes or granulocytes is smaller. So in this case, it was a clear evidence that there is an interaction between the cosine and some components of the plasma, and one of the majority components of the plasma or the proteins. So we check by boron NMR spectra if there is interaction between the cosine and the plasma proteins. And to do this, we prepare a solution of 200 micromolar of sodium cosine in different media, in water, in the phosphate buffer solution, and in two different media. In one of this media, it was the presence of bobin, fetal bobin serum. And we can observe that in only in this green spectra, that is the one that corresponds to the media that contains the protein, the aggregation is formed. So this is a clear evidence that there is interaction, the cosine, with the proteins. And just to finish, or the studies in vivo. This was done in Professor Nakamura Laboratories, and a solution that contains 7.5 milligrams of bor per kilo was injected to the tail of a mice, and it was sacrificed, and after 30, one group after 30 minutes, and the other group of mice after 60 minutes. And this is the biodistribution of the cosine that clearly indicates that at the beginning, after 30 minutes, there is a lot of cosine in the liver and in the lungs. But when the time go on, the quantity of the cosine in the lungs increases. So all these results have been published recently, two weeks ago, in chemistry. And just to finish, I want to thank the people from our group, but especially for the day a day, but especially Francesc Teixidor, Elena Olechkiewicz for the magnetic nanoparticles, and Isabel Fuentes for the cosine DNA interaction. And just to say that I consider, this is the point of view of mine, that I consider that our group is a ground-up group in boron chemistry. But in order to develop the fruits, in this case, approaching boron cluster in medicine, it is required that the tree develop roots to the proper expertise laboratory. So I think all this collaboration for the support. And also, I do not want to miss the financial support from the Spanish government and the Generalitat de Catalunya. And all of you for your kind attention.
Thank you so much for this, say, brilliant lecture, for the inspiring presentation, and for staying time. So there is now plenty of time for questions. On the bottom, we have two questions. First, David.
Yes, thank you, Clara. Very, very nice lecture. Interesting results. I was wondering, you commented upon the accumulation of the your clusters in cancer cells. What about competitive experiments? Actually, you also commented upon the accumulation in healthy cells, but what about competitive experiments where the carborane cluster can enter, the nanoparticles functionalized with carborane cluster can enter both cancer and healthy cells, like in a real therapeutic setting. Right. In therapy, you will always have healthy cells and cancer cells in competition. Is there an accumulation in cancer cells, a significant accumulation, and if so, how big is it?
But what it is important here, you are fully right, that after administration of a drug, if it's intravenous administration, the drug spares over the body, the full body. But what it is important in this BNCT therapy is that the compound does not produce any effect if there is not the radiation with the thermal neutrons. So you can drive the radiation to the proper part of the body, I mean to the tumor tissue. And the rest of the body is not irradiated. So there is no alpha particles that destroy the healthy tissues, let's say, in this way.
Okay, but in order to be even more provocative, so what is then the advantage to conventional radiation therapy, where you can actually directly irradiate, say, better irradiation, high energy beta irradiation, if you don't have this selectivity?
This is why, to take advance on the normal radiation, what we plan is to attack the cancer by two different type of therapies. What is the meaning of this? That you can decrease the doses of the drug to get the same effect. So this means that the secondary effects will be decreased.
If I may add a very brief second question, have you ever attached a protein to your carborane, which is, for instance, overexpressed in malignant cells, which may increase the selectivity?
More work is doing on this, and we have already studies on how the cosine interact with the protein. But we're not finished yet.
Thank you very much. There's a question there.
And then thank you for your very interesting and inspiring lecture. And my questions are associated with magnetic nanoparticles. First of all, do you work with isotopically enriched boron precursors or use natural distribution of isotopes, boron 10 and boron 11? And the second question is about the mechanism of internalization of magnetic nanoparticles into cells. How do they penetrate the membrane?
Wow, this is very difficult to say. They are inside, by sure, but we cannot say which is the mechanism by crossing the membranes.
Keep it like this.
We do not know. And we do not know which is the mechanism by crossing membranes of cosine, but we know or there. But we can be sure to say that the cosine, in the case of cosine, the magnetic nanoparticles, we have not studied this. But in the case of cosine, we are sure that are into the nucleus. But there is a recent theoretical paper that explains that the nuclear membrane has a holes in which the anions cross. So if we have anions and the nuclear membrane has this type of holes that allow anions to cross this through these holes, in the case of cosine, I can say that this theoretical calculation support the crossing, but I do not know about the cellular membrane. There is no... We are studying by... in a collaboration with one group that produces this type of calculation, but not results at all.
Thank you very much. And what about the isotopic distribution? You use natural.
Can you put the question once again, please?
Do you use?
No, at this moment we use natural boron.
Natural
boron, yes.
Okay, let's. And,
but the amount is enough. Because it's more than 26 micrograms yes. of boron 10 per gram of cells.
Thank you very much. Maybe
if we want to apply by BNCT, by sure, we can start using as a starting material carborane 100% of boron 10. But this, or as I said, starting the research. Let's see what it will be.
So we have a very quick question.
Yes, I...
Last one.
Thank you, Clara, for your brilliant presentation. But I think I have to explain something to our colleagues at this plenary section, because one of the question is what is the difference between cancer cells and the normal cells, and why the nanoparticles have more prone to enter cancer cells. So there is an effect that is called enhanced permeation retention effect that is particularly observed for nanoparticles, because cancer cells as because tumors as holes, and nanoparticles are attracted for their holes and be retained there. So that's the effect of nanoparticles. And of course, each time we test a new drug, we have to use normal cells. It's the proof of principle to be specific and selective for the cancer cells and be not so toxic for normal cells. But in this particular case where you use nanoparticles, this effect, enhanced permeation retention effect, is observed for nanoparticles, because that special particular particularity of cancer cells is that they have holes. And another, the nanoparticles are retained. Well, I have other things to do. And the mechanism for the uptake in cells for nanoparticles usually is endocytosis. So this more typical mechanism of entrance. So usually. These particular compounds enters by that mechanism, caveolae, endocytosis, and just the entrance is very easy by this not energy-dependent mechanism, some of them.
Okay, thank you.
The normal drugs enter by endocytosis, but in this case, we think it's because the compound, the anion compound, is soluble in water and in organic solvents. So probably is dissolution in the same way as gold nanoparticles enter into the cells or by extraction, because we have no evidence of endocytosis by them.
Okay, I would suggest to finish here the discussion and then to
okay.
It's a personal discussion later on. So thank you. Thank Clara for this very nice lecture. Thank you so much.